I want to talk about the subject, what type of propositions are economic propositions? What type of theory is economic theory? Are economic statements or economic propositions axiomatic, deductive? Is economics an axiomatic deductive science, or is it what we call an empirical science? Or to put that differently, are economic propositions derived from some firmly established, incontrovertible starting point, and provided that no mistake in the process of deduction are made, then apodictically true statements, or are economic propositions hypotheses that require continuous testing? And I want to show why Austrians believe that economic propositions are more akin to logical statements or mathematical statements, and why they are not hypothetical statements. And I want to explain also why the answer to this fundamental question that I want to raise and address is of utmost importance, why it is important to realize what type of statements economic statements are, because lots of consequences follow depending whether we decide they are hypotheses or they are more akin to logical or mathematical statements. If we look at the present situation, then we have to say that almost everyone, except for the Austrians, believe that economic statements are hypothetical statements that require continuous testing. This does not mean that all mainstream economists actually practice what they preach. That is, very frequently, when you look at what they actually do, you see it seems they believe that certain statements are apodictically true, but their officially affirmed view is all statements are hypotheses. Only the Austrians are of hold a different belief. Now, when I say that this is the current situation, I have to immediately add that the current situation is a relatively new situation. Until about the 1950s or so, it was the standard view that economic propositions are not hypothetical statements, that economic statements are apodictically true statements. Almost all people before 1950 held the view that nowadays only the Austrians hold. The person who somehow persuaded the economics profession of the new view, all economic statements are hypothetical statements, was Milton Friedman. Before that, the most prominent author writing on methodological questions relating to economics was Lionel Robbins, and his most famous book is called An Essay on the Nature and Significance of Economic Science. And Lionel Robbins had been heavily influenced by Ludwig von Mises. He was a frequent guest in Vienna. He was a chairman of the economics department at the London School of Economics. He was also responsible for hiring Hayek to become a professor at the London School of Economics. So Lionel Robbins' position was considered to be more or less the mainstream position until the 1950s. And almost all major economists before Lionel Robbins and Mises held onto a similar view. Just to name a few names, Jean-Baptiste Say held the view that these are not just hypothetical statements. Nassau Senior held this view. John Cairns held this view, and so forth. The adoption of the new view about the nature of economic science is due to the influence of a group of philosophers, the so-called logical empiricists, or also referred to as the positivists. And this group of philosophers had their headquarters, so to speak, in Vienna. They also had some side branches in Berlin, but Vienna was the center of the group of logical positivists. They call it in philosophy the so-called Vienna Circle, or at the time they called it the Schlick Circle, named after a philosopher, Moritz Schlick. In Vienna, various circles of intellectuals existed. The Schlick Circle was just one of many. Another one was the Mises Circle. Ludwig von Mises was very familiar with the philosophy of the logical positivists because his brother, Richard von Mises, was a prominent member of this group as well. Richard von Mises was a famous mathematician and probability theorist. In Vienna itself, the logical positivists were not too influential, I would say, but almost all of the leading proponents of positivism emigrated in the early 30s to Anglo-Saxon countries, mostly to the United States, but also to Britain and New Zealand, various other places, and became quite prominent in the United States, whereas they were not exactly influential in Europe. Again, to give you a few names, I already mentioned Moritz Schlick, then Rudolf Carnap, Hans Reichenbach, Gustav Hempel, Otto Neurath, and also not directly a member of the Vienna Circle, but on the fringes of the Vienna Circle, Karl Popper. And due to the influence of these philosophers, who many of them got quite big shot positions in the United States, in contrast to the positions that they held in Europe, their philosophy became for decades, so to speak, the dominant school of philosophy. This is no longer the case nowadays, but their view that they propounded is still to this day held by the practitioners of sciences, in particular also by the practitioners of economics. I want to briefly explain what the basic views of the positivists were, and take in particular the views proposed by Karl Popper, because his views became, so to speak, the most influential ones. I'm not claiming that what I present now about Popper's views will do justice to the entire philosophy that that Popper developed. 30 years ago, I was some sort of expert on Popper. In the meantime, I forgot most of it. I want to just highlight, so to speak, the point of Popper's philosophy that became almost a popular doctrine. And according to this popular version of Popperism, there exist two types of scientific statements. The first type of statement is referred to as empirical statements. Empirical statements say something about the real world. They refer to something that exists. Empirical statements must, according to Popper, in principle, falsifiable by experience. That is, experience must be capable of showing that this statement is false. If we cannot imagine, so to speak, some observation that would possibly prove something wrong, then this is not a legitimate scientific statement. So all empirical statements must be falsifiable, at least in principle. And that is to say, nothing else, they must be hypothetical. Experience can always be this way or it can be that way. We do not know what it is unless we make certain types of observations and then we decide it is this way or it is that way. And then, as a corollary of this statement, positivists claim that there is nothing that we can know about reality with certainty or apodictically. Everything that refers to reality is hypothetical. Nothing can be known about the real world with certainty. And the second type of statement that is legitimate according to the positivists are what we call analytical statements. Analytical statements say nothing about the reality at all. Analytical statements are nothing more than definitions. One sign is defined by another sign. Bachelor means unmarried men. Analytical statements can, of course, be, we can be absolutely certain about them because we have simply defined the words in this way. That bachelor means unmarried man is not a falsifiable statement. That is just simply the way we define certain terms. Analytical statements have, so to speak, no cognitive content. We do not recognize anything about the real world by knowing analytical statements. This implies, for instance, that mathematical statements or logical statements or statements that in philosophy are referred to as ontological statements that claim to be absolutely true, apodictically true, do not say anything about real phenomena. That's the view of the positivist. Mathematics has nothing to do with the real world. Logic has nothing to do with the real world. Those things we can know for sure, but again, nothing, no relationship with real phenomena. If there are only these two types of statements, analytical statements and empirical statements, that it follows also from that no such thing as ethics is a scientific discipline, because ethical statements would be normative statements, say what we should do. What is justified and what is not justified for us to do. Those are just matters of taste according to the positivists. No rational ethics exists in their view. I will not dwell much on this in my criticism of the positivists. That will be something that I cover in another lecture where I talk about ethics and law. I just want to point that out. That they hold this view. Then they has also in the second main tenet of the positivists is that scientific explanations are always of the same type. They're always if-then statements. If such and such is the case, then such and such will follow. If A, then B, or if A, then C. These explanations are, of course, again, hypothetical statements. Hypothetical statements need to be tested. If we formulate the hypothesis, if A, then B, and we make the observation that A is indeed the case, and B can indeed be observed as the hypothesis states, then we speak of a confirmation of the hypothesis. A confirmation of a hypothesis is not a verification. That is, if A is indeed the case and B does follow as the hypothesis hypothesizes, then we have not shown that this hypothesis is right. All we have shown is this hypothesis has not been refuted up to this point. It has been confirmed. Why do we not say that it has been verified or has been proven right? The answer is the hypothesis, of course, refers to all instances of if A. And there are an infinite number of A's. So if we just show in one case of A, B did indeed follow, it does not follow from this that in all instances of A's, B will follow. All we have shown is so far we have not found a refutation of it. The second outcome that can be is if A then B, A is observed, and then B does not occur. In this case, we would say the hypothesis has been falsified. We know then that at least in the way that we stated the hypothesis, it must be wrong because there is an instance where B simply did not follow A. However, a falsification also does not mean that there is no relationship between A and B. Only what follows from it is that the way we formulate the hypothesis, that exact formulation cannot be right. It might be, however, that A and B are related, except we have to control for another factor. If you control for C, then if A, then B follows. That is, we have in principle, whenever we find a falsification, the option of reformulating our hypothesis, introducing another variable that we have not up to now controlled. But if we would control it, then the relationship would hold as we stated it. And if this is falsified, again, we would have the possibility of saying, so A and B are indeed related, as we said, but we have to control not only C, but we have to control also D and E and F and so forth. So a falsification is also a temporary thing, so to speak. It does not definitely show that A and B have nothing to do with each other, but only shows they cannot be related as simply as we assumed in the from the outset. So if I summarize the view of the positivists, then we can say their central thesis is we have no knowledge about the world that is non-hypothetical. There is nothing that we can know about the world that does not require some sort of testing. Now, before I go into a more detailed critique, I want to give you some statements about the world of which I claim that they do say something about the real world, and nonetheless, they are not hypothetical statements. That is, this view is from the outset not exactly very plausible. Just to give you a few examples. No material thing can be at two places at once. So this obviously says something about the real world. Is it, however, something that requires any type of testing? Or would we just say a person who just thinks this needs to be tested simply has not grasped what we have said. Another example. No two objects can occupy the same place. Again, I would claim this is something that says something about the real world. It is not just a definition. Nonetheless, is this a hypothesis? What strikes me to be the case is this is certainly not a hypothesis. And nonetheless, we have recognized something that is true about real phenomena. A straight line is the shortest distance between two points. And it says something about real phenomena. Is it a hypothesis? Does it require any testing? How would we even test this sort of thing? No two straight lines can enclose a space. Again, that seems to be true. And certainly not just a mere hypothesis that requires any type of testing. We would not go out and just draw straight lines and another straight line and another straight line and find out whether these two straight lines ever enclose a space. Whatever object is green all over cannot be yellow all over at the same time. It strikes me that this is something that says something about the real world. Nonetheless, I would not know what an experiment would have to look like that could show whether the statement is right or wrong. We grasp it, and once we have grasped it, we see this is, of course, a statement that is non-hypothetically true about real phenomena. If A is a part of B and B is a part of C, then A is a part of C also. Again, a statement about real things, and nonetheless, certainly nothing that strikes us as being hypothetical. So now let me give you some examples where we have clearly hypothetical statements at hand and show in which way they are really different. Let's say statements like, children prefer McDonald's over Burger King. We certainly do not know by hearing the statement whether that is true or not. Indeed, we would have to collect data and find out whether this is really the case that children prefer McDonald's over Burger King. We could say the opposite, so to speak, of this statement. Children prefer Burger King over McDonald's without stating something that is, on the face of it, nonsensical. Worldwide beef consumption to pork consumption is 2-to-1. People consume twice as much beef as pork. Whether that is true or not, we would have to find out. We would have to make observations. And again, it would not be nonsensical to say that it is just the other way around, that pork consumption outstrips beef consumption. Germans prefer Spain over Greece as a vacation destination. That might be true, that might be false. We have to find out which one is true. Simply by saying it, we do not know what is the case. We could also just claim the opposite and would obviously not speak some nonsense that Germans prefer to go to Greece rather than Spain. On the other hand, recall statements like no two straight lines can enclose a space. If somebody would say, denies this, would say it is false that no two straight lines can enclose a space, then we would immediately say this is from the outset a nonsensical statement. So very different types of statements. So now we come to economic examples. Examples from economic theory, and let's take a look, so to speak, do they resemble the first type of statements more, or do they resemble the type of statements that I just gave later on? Take for instance this one. In every voluntary exchange, both exchange partners must benefit from the exchange, otherwise the exchange would not have taken place. Is that a hypothesis? Is that a statement like Germans prefer Greece or Spain over as a vacation destination? Whatever we give away in exchange, we must consider as less valuable than whatever we acquire in an exchange. Is that a hypothesis? Or is that something that is a non-hypothetically true statement about real phenomena? Take another example. Whenever we impose a minimum wage that is set above current wage rates, let's say a minimum wage of $1,000 per minute, then unemployment will result. Certain people that would strike a deal before can no longer strike a deal because of this minimum wage law that is enforced. Is that a hypothesis, or is that something that we grasp as being necessarily true, given the way we have defined our terms? Or take this one. If we double, triple, quadruple the amount of money in existence, while the amount of consumer and producer goods remains constant, what will happen? The level of prices will go up. Is this a hypothetical prediction, or is this something that we can grasp as necessarily true, knowing what money is, knowing what consumer goods are, knowing what producer goods are? Or last example, under socialism, cost accounting is impossible. That is, we cannot compare input prices with output prices. The explanation for this is, as you have heard, I think Guido Hülsmann mentioned it yesterday, is if there exist no prices for factors of production, because all factors of production are owned by one entity, by the government, and there is no price for land, there is no price for machinery, there are no prices for office buildings and so forth, then obviously we cannot compare input prices with output prices and determine whether we produced efficiently, that is, whether we transformed something that was less valuable into something that is more valuable, or alternatively, we produced something that was more valuable into something that was less valuable. We can only do this if we have money prices for the input factors and we have money prices for the output. Again, is this a theorem? Is this a proposition that is hypothetical, or does that simply follow from the way that the words are used in order to describe certain phenomena? Now, what strikes me that all of these statements that I have given about economic theory are indeed precisely what positivists deny as possible. That is, they are all statements about real phenomena, and they are non-hypothetical. Once we have grasped them, then we can see that they capture, so to speak, the essence of things. Now, we do not need to go out and test them. According to the positivists, however, this cannot be. According to the positivists, for instance, because all statements that say something about reality are hypotheses, it must be possible to reverse the formulation, to negate these economic laws and not say something that is on the face of it nonsense. So, for instance, take the example that I gave, whatever I give away must be considered as less valuable in my eyes than whatever I acquire. So, if this is just a hypothesis, it must be possible to say, for instance, whatever I give away is considered by whoever gives it away as more valuable than whatever the person acquires in exchange. Now, on the face of this seems to be a nonsensical statement. Nonetheless, according to the positivists, it is not a nonsensical statement. We have to try this out, so to speak. So, what follows from this is of utmost importance. If all statements are hypothetical statements, then we always have to try out whether something is the case or is not the case. So, for instance, we must first institute socialism and then find out whether we can calculate or we cannot calculate. According to Austrians who think that we are capable of formulating non-hypothetically true statements about the real world, it is not necessary in order to find out whether this is right or wrong to introduce socialism first. We know it in advance that this is the case. The same with minimum wage laws. A positivist would say, since this is just a hypothesis, a minimum wage of $10,000 per minute, we can formulate the hypothesis causes unemployment, but we can also negate this statement. A minimum wage law of $10,000 a minute increases employment. On the face of it, this is a legitimate statement according to them. On the face, according to Austrians, this is, of course, from the outset, a ridiculous statement. What would a positivist have to do in order to find out whether he is right or wrong? Whether more employment will result or less employment will result? The answer, we have to try it out. So let's do this. And if we then observe that a minimum wage of $10,000 a minute will indeed lead to massive unemployment, what is then the possibility that they have? The possibility that they then have is to say, oh, that is just because certain other important variables have been neglected to be taken into account. But once we take that into account, then we will observe indeed that more employment will result. And if this doesn't work, then of course, another variable can be introduced. This also has to be controlled. This also has to be controlled, and so forth. So the philosophy implied in logical positivism is we engage in social engineering. We must try out everything before we know an answer. And whatever the answer is, we always have a way of finding an excuse why our hypothesis didn't work the way it was supposed to work. Now here you also have a motive, so to speak, why this philosophy of positivism, of social engineering, Popper calls it piecemeal social engineering, why this became so very popular. Ask yourself how many research assistants a guy like Mises needed in order to write his books, how many people he employed to collect certain data, then go out in the world and collect these data and analyze them and so forth, and then in the end come up with some answer. And the answer is, of course, he never used a research assistant in his entire life. There was no horde of people, of empirical researchers, who wasted a huge amount of money to give an answer to a question that you can immediately recognize, this is absolutely ridiculous, and this is something that is absolutely, absolutely true. That is, the entire positivist philosophy is a huge employment program for people to find out things, either that water flows down, which we already know, or sometimes, if they are even more ridiculous, they find even sometimes it flows upward. Most economists in this world would instantly unemployed if the view of the Austrians would be adopted. So this tells you roughly something about the resistance that you will find in the mainstream against adopting a view that shows that all what they do is by and large a bunch of nonsense. Now I want to at least develop some slightly more systematic argument in order to refute the positivistic doctrine. And I will do this by employing what is called in philosophy self-referential arguments. That is, applying their own thesis to themselves. So again, recall, all scientific statements are either empirical, then they are hypothetical, or they are analytical, they're just definitions. Then it's only fair to ask, what type of statement is this? That is, what type of statement is a statement? All statements are either analytical or they are empirical. Now, obviously, we have only two choices if the positivists are right. One choice is this statement is also an empirical statement, but then it is just a hypothesis. So how can they be so sure that there are only these two statements if they themselves, according to their own doctrine, have to admit that it's all hypothetical? So wouldn't we have to test that out forever, look at all types of statements that people ever make and find out whether that fits into that category or into that category? So far, I have not seen any positivist that engaged in this type of exercise, collecting, maybe that would be a big research program also, just collecting all statements that people ever made and find out whether they fit into these two categories. The other alternative is, it has to be an analytical statement. But if it's an analytical statement, then it is just a definition. We simply define things in such a way that it is either analytical or it is empirical, but then we can simply say, so what? Then I define things differently. After all, I'm free to make any definitions that I want. Any definition is as good as any other definition, because they are all just agreements on the use of certain symbols. In any case, we do not have any sort of epistemology at hand. There is, of course, a third alternative. The third alternative would be this statement, that is, all statements are empirical or analytical, is itself neither empirical nor is it analytical. What could it be? What it could be is, of course, it could be a non-hypothetical statement about something that is real. And then we have to admit, of course, that what the positivists deny does, in fact, exist. In order to make their own position a defensible position, they must actually accept that there is something different from empirical statements and analytical statements, namely what in Kantian terminology they called it, synthetic a priori statements, statements that say something about the real world, and they are non-hypothetical. We can do the same exercise with their view of explanation, of scientific explanations. All explanations are if-then statements. What type of explanation, however, is the explanation of an explanation? That is, we have just explained what an explanation is. Is this also an if statement, a hypothetical statement? Or do they claim that this is the real essence of what an explanation is? If it is the real essence of what an explanation is, then again, we are trapped in some sort of contradiction. We must accept there exist obviously other types of statements than the two sort of statements that positivists accept as legitimate scientific explanations. Now I want to, the last part of my explanation, I want to show that the falsificationist methodology developed by Popper, however, whatever the possibility of applying it in the natural sciences might be, that it definitely cannot apply in the sciences of human action. Again, by using some self-referential arguments. In order to see this, take a look at this scheme here that explains roughly how positivists in the Popperite tradition see the process of science going on. You formulate a hypothesis, and then you subject the hypothesis to a test. And there can be two outcomes. One is the hypothesis is falsified, and that requires that we have to revise our hypothesis. The other alternative is we can confirm it. And if it is confirmed, and recall, this does not mean that we have shown it to be true. We have only shown it that it is so far has not been refuted. So then we have to retry it. And so forth. And then again, the revised hypothesis can be either falsified or confirmed, and the confirmed hypothesis can, in the next retest, can be again falsified, or it can be confirmed, and so on and so on. This is how Popper views the progress of science. Progress takes place through falsification, reformulation, retest, and so forth, and then gradually gradually we approach the truth more and more, so to speak. Now I want to make you aware of the fact that we must make an assumption in order to proceed in the way that the positivists want to proceed us. Let's say I falsify a hypothesis, if A, then B, and A is the case, and B does not occur. What is necessary that we can say this is a falsification? Why can't we just simply say, in one case, A was followed by B, and in another case, A was not followed by B? Why would we say that these two observations, one observation A was followed by B, and another observation, A was not followed by B, why would we say that the second observation falsifies the first one, or contradicts the first one? We must make an assumption in order to say this is a falsification. The assumption is things don't change in the course of time. The nature of things remains the same. If, on the other hand, we would say, no, sometimes A is followed by B, and sometimes A is not followed by B. So we just have one experience, and then we have another experience. Why do we say that these two experiences contradict each other? If things are not constant in nature, we would just simply state, one time it was this way, and another time it was that way, and that's it. With confirmation, the same thing. So we have one experiment, A was followed by B as predicted. Then we make another experiment, A is again followed by B as predicted. Why do we say that the second observation confirms the first one? If the world itself, so to speak, undergoes change in the course of time, we would simply have to say, okay, we made this observation, then we made that observation. They look the same, but nothing follows from it. That is not a confirmation. Only if we make the assumption the nature of things does not change in the course of time can these two observations either be interpreted as a falsification of what we previously said or a confirmation of what we previously said. So now ask yourself this. This constancy assumption, without which we can neither relate to experiences as confirming each other or falsifying each other, this constancy assumption, can that be made when it comes to human action? And I want to argue that that is impossible to do. Take the person who conducts these types of experiments. That is the researcher who follows the positivist methodology. Now, we start with a hypothesis. Then we either confirm it or we falsify it. What has happened to the experimenter, to the researcher? Is the researcher the same one that he was before? Does he know exactly the same thing that he knows before, or does he know something more than he knew at the beginning? And the answer is, of course, the sole purpose of this exercise is we want to learn something that we did not learn from the outset. Why do we otherwise produce this sort of thing? Why do we proceed in this way? We admit that at the beginning of the process, we knew less than we knew when we go to step two, or to step three, or step four, and so forth. That is, every time we conduct the experiment and observe such and such is the outcome, or such and such is the outcome, we have become a different person, or at least in the sense that we know something that we did not know at the outset. And with different knowledge accumulated, we act differently. Our knowledge influences what we do. That is, the constancy assumption that we can do in the natural sciences cannot be accepted when it comes to human action. We have then, so to speak, two parts of the social sciences that follows from this. One thing is, insofar as our actions can be influenced by our knowledge and by our change of knowledge, no scientific laws are possible. Because if scientific laws exist, how we learn, what we learn, when we learn it, and so forth, how our knowledge changes and affects our actions, then we would not have to engage in any research at all. Then we already know everything there is to know from the outset. On the other hand, what we have also realized is we can say something about action that is universally true. Namely, that this type of assumption, the constancy assumption, cannot be made as far as human action is concerned. This is a universally true statement about human actions. So we have theoretical statements about actions as such. And we have historical statements about what concrete choices people did at various points in time, depending on the type of knowledge that they had at this time or at that time. Let me explain this. This dualism of theoretical statements regarding human action and historical statements regarding human action by referring to what is probably the most fundamental of economic laws, the law of marginal utility. Let me just briefly formulate the law. It says, if the supply of a homogeneous good increases, the marginal utility decreases, and vice versa. That is, if the supply of a homogeneous good decreases, then the marginal utility increases. Let me briefly explain the terms here. Supply is clear. Increase of supply, decrease of supply. Homogeneous goods are goods each unit of which is considered by us as being equally serviceable with respect to the ends that we pursue. Now, how do we derive this law? If I have a supply of one orange, what will I do with this one orange? I will use this orange in order to pursue the most valuable goal that can be reached with the help of one unit of this good, namely an orange. If I have two oranges, then the first unit will be used in order to satisfy my most highly ranking desire of all the desires that can be satisfied with the help of an orange. The second one can, by definition, only be used in order to satisfy my second most highly ranking goal of all the goals that can be satisfied with the help of an orange. If I have three, then I can satisfy my most highly ranking goal, my second most highly ranking goal, and my third most highly ranking goal. If one unit is taken away from my supply, it doesn't matter which orange will be taken away from me because they are homogeneous. Each one can serve the same ends. But nonetheless, I must give up one satisfaction. Which satisfaction will I give up? By having to give up one orange, I will give up the least important one of the various goals that can be satisfied with the help of an orange. Now, it should be perfectly clear that this is, again, something that is non-hypothetically true about something real. But you also realize what this law does not say. The law does not say which one is my most highly ranking goal. That is my most highly ranking goal to turn the orange into orange juice or to just peel it and then eat the fruit just like this? Or is my most highly ranking goal that can be satisfied with an orange that I want to use it as a baseball? None of this economic theory predicts. It also does not predict at all whether my most highly ranking goal today will also be my most highly ranking goal tomorrow. It also does not say anything whether my most highly ranking goal has anything to do with what your most highly ranking goal is. All of this can, of course, be affected by changes in knowledge. If I learn something new about oranges, then the rank order of various goals might change. I might also learn that oranges cannot be even used for something that I thought before they might be usable for. In this regard, economics is very humble. We cannot say anything about this. Cannot say what purpose ranks more highly and what purpose ranks less highly. We cannot say how this will change in the course of time. We can only reconstruct that after the event, so to speak, or we can speculate how it is. Speculation is obviously nothing that is about which we can be certain that will be the case. Nonetheless, the law of marginal utility is true. So we have to see, as Austrian economists, we are on the one hand more ambitious than mainstream economists, and on the other hand, we are far more humble than mainstream economists. We say certain things we can know with certainty, with apodictic certainty. They are not hypotheses. On the other hand, we also recognize that many things that mainstream economists try to do, because they try to predict what people will do in the future, how they will use oranges or whatever machines, many things that they try to do, we would consider to be an impossibility, something that entrepreneurs can do. But there is no scientific theory of entrepreneurship. Because if there would be a science of entrepreneurship, then of course we could all learn the formulas that make us successful entrepreneurs. And obviously, economists are not exactly successful entrepreneurs. Otherwise, they would not teach the nonsense that they teach. They would just earn millions in the market. So we are more ambitious in some respects. And in many respects, we would say we are humble know-nothings. We leave that up to entrepreneurs who risk their own money in making predictions, but there is no science of entrepreneurship that we can learn by reading some books. Thank you very much.